church on Sunday morning. Grandma's hand played a tambourine so well. Grandma's hand used to issue out a warning. She'd say, Billy, don't you run so fast. Might fall on a piece of glass. Might be snakes there in that grass. Grandma's hand. The local unwed mother. Grandma's hand used to ache sometimes and swell. Grandma's hand used to lift her face and tell her, she'd say, baby, grandma, understand that you really love that man. Put yourself in Jesus' hands. Grandma's hand. Used to hand me a piece of candy. Grandma's hand picked me up each time I fell. Grandma's hand, boy, they really came in a handy. She'd say, Matty, don't you whip that boy. What you wanna spank him for? He didn't drop no apple core. But I don't have grandma anymore. If I get to heaven, I'll look for grandma's hand.
Cardell is originally from Forest, Mississippi. He left home when he was 13 years old to make money and take it back home to the family. He was the youngest of 8 children or 9 or something. And he made it as far as the Kentucky Derby. He was a, took care of the horses, what do you call it, a stable boy. And then moved up to Indianapolis. So Cardell was doing his first comedy when he was 17 in strip joints and whatever there was. I don't think he had any idea about being funny, but, you know, it was just, apparently it worked, because that's how he started making money. And then he really got into it. He, while he was working in Indianapolis, he met, now I can't think of the guy's name, he was the kingfish for Amos and Andy.
Okay.
I don't recall his name. And as a matter of fact, there are two people with the same name, so... But anyway, he said to him, he said, boy, I'm going to teach you how to do comedy. And so the somehow or other, I don't know how Cardell connected with Red Fox.
Hey, Brady, do you know about you, my friend?
Who was in Harlem making his living doing dishes.
No, me either.
He never made any money until Cotton Comes to Harlem, until he made that movie. He was in his 70s by that time. He hadn't made a dime on comedy. And then Cardell somehow got hooked up with a group, the Everly Brothers, and he did a little stint in Nevada, not in Las Vegas, but they were in Reno and they were in Sparks, I know. And then that was the part that kind of stuck with him, I think. And after that experience, he knew he wanted to do comedy.
I met Cardell Monday night at Sardino's. God, I can't even remember the year. It had to be 1981.
Okay. Same thing. It was Sardino's open mic. He was in wrong place, wrong time. He was comedy, and then the clubs kind of came around, and he was older. He was, you know, Chris, now we're looked at as the elder statesman. You know, it doesn't seem so old now when you're that age. But back then, we were in our early 20s. Look at all this. Cardell, he's, you know, talking about these old guys like Dick Gregory and well, you heard of Richard Pryor, but some people that, you know, they never even heard of before. Now we're that guy. The young guys look up to us. But we have clubs and the internet that we could go off to. Cardell didn't have anything. I think he didn't get his due. I'm sorry to hear that. That's why we're doing this.
Yeah. He's a very smart man. Just based off the fact that if he didn't know, he was going to find out. Just stubbornly curious, I guess you could say.
He went to school, if you can call it that, where everybody got a book, but maybe you got a math book, maybe you got a history book, but you didn't get, you know, what we're very accustomed to getting as our divine right. You didn't get that. And maybe that is something that kind of fueled his passion, because he wanted to learn everything about everything.
The man was a student of life. He read, he watched TV. If he was alive now, he'd probably be on Wikipedia right now looking up stuff. He just absorbed any and everything he could.
Because comedy is your life, it's your mistress, it's your family, and Cardell chose to be compartmentalized and live vicariously his dream through us. Comedians are just not functional people. You know, they're just not. And I think Cardell really understood that, and he was a bridge between the bar owners who are completely whacked in their own way. This is not comedy clubs here, these are just bar owners. These were just, you know, slugs. They're trying to sell beer. They didn't care about comedy, they didn't care about art, they didn't care about our father, didn't love us, that's why we need the stage love. You know, and Cardell was a real bridge between that. And I think he was just a gentleman, and without playing the race card, he went into places where white people would never let a black guy in. And he brought a Chris Barnes in there, where they would, and it's just, it was comedy. It wasn't anybody who was white or black, or anybody who was young or old, entertaining audiences. And I think he was great about that. And I will go to my death saying he was the number one influence in my comedy life. He was it.
You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need